Hello guys, welcome to the Anatomy Hub. Today we will study about the white matter fibers or the white matter bundles of the cerebrum and what is this white matter that we will discuss and how this white matters are arranged inside the cerebrum, that also we will discuss. Okay, so here we'll discuss some clinical anatomy also related to this white matter fibers and its dysfunctions. So first we have to know actually what is this white matter fibers. Okay, so what is this white matter? First you have to know that, right? So the white matter, actually it is the bundle of axons that is present inside the central nervous system, that will be known as the white matter bundle. Okay, so like that, you know about the neuron, right? If you have seen the neuron, no, you can see there is the presence of the cell body and the dendrites and the axons, right? So group of cell bodies that is present inside the central nervous system, that is known as your gray matter. But the group of or the bundle of axons present inside the central nervous system, that will be your white matter. Okay, but again these white matter fibers, they are arranged in different ways. Like some white matter fibers are going upward, some white matter fibers are going downward, some are going from means they are connecting from anterior to posterior of the cerebrum or to the central nervous system, and some are connected from the lateral side to the lateral side. So in this way we can divide these white matter fibers into so many types, and again these types will be divided into subtypes, right? So the cerebral white matter, that is a compact mass of vast number of nerve fiber and that associated with the neuroglia, right? What is this neuroglia? These neuroglia are the supporting cells, like your connective tissue, okay, inside the central nervous system, that is the neuroglia. So these white matter fibers that lies deep to the cerebral cortex, that you can see here in this picture, and forms the large volume of each cerebral hemisphere. So these white matter fibers, they have mainly three types of fibers, like your association fibers, striatal fibers and the cord fibers, right? So these association fibers, they connect cerebral cortex. Association fibers, striatal fibers or cord fibers. These association fibers connect the cerebral cortical areas within the same hemisphere, and striatal fibers communicate between the cortex and the basal ganglia, and the cord fibers connect areas on opposite side of the brain. That means what you will see here you will see the association fibers from that is connected from the anterior to posterior, okay, like your fronto occipital, you can say, okay, from frontal gyrus to the occipital gyrus, in means in same hemisphere, but they are connecting from anterior to posterior or posterior to anterior. These are the association fibers. Like that you will find the striatal fibers. They actually communicate from the here at the base, you will find the thalamus, the basal nuclei. Okay, and from there the fibers, they are going upward and connecting to the cerebral cortex. Like that, from the cerebral cortex the axons, they are coming downward and connected to the thalamus, basal nuclei and like this gray matters, right? So these upgoing and downgoing fibers are known as the striatal fibers. Okay, and you'll find the cord fibers. So these cord fibers that actually connect the area on opposite side of the brain. Means here you'll find, if you'll find over here is the temporal lobe, and other side also you'll find the temporal lobe, right? So in between these two temporal lobes, both the side, they are communicating with each other by the bundle of axons, and these axons are known as the cord fibers. You can also divide these white matter fibers into inside the cerebral hemisphere into three types also. So these types are most commonly used as a commissural fibers, association fibers, and the projection fibers, right? So the projection fibers, that is actually nothing but the cord fibers, and association fibers are those fibers coming to the anterior to posterior communication, and commissural fibers from lateral to lateral connection. Okay, so these fibers of white matter, they connect the various part of the cerebral cortex with each other and to the other part of the central nervous system. So they are actually classified into the following three types that you can see in the screen on the basis of the types of connection they provide. So here you'll find the association fibers in green color that you can see over here, and you'll find the commissural fibers that is in pink color that you can see over here and here, and these are the projection fibers in blue in color. We'll start here right now one by one, okay, about all these white matter bundles. So here you'll see that first we'll study about the commissural fibers, okay. So actually these commissural fibers, they interconnect the identical corresponding areas of the two cerebral hemispheres that you can observe over here. You can say it is interhemispheric fibers, and these bundles of such fibers, they are actually termed as the commissures. Okay, so the important commissures of the brain that you can see is follows over here as a corpus callosum, anterior commissure, posterior commissure, and you'll find the hippocampal commissure, or that is also known as your fornix over here, and you'll find the habenular commissure. Okay, so here you have to note that the commissural fibers, they are very much essential for the interhemispheric transfer of information for the bilateral response and the learning process. Okay, so the primary visual area and hand region of the primary somatosensory area of the cortex have no known commissural fibers, that you have to remember over here. So about this corpus callosum, we'll see first about the corpus callosum. So this corpus callosum that you can observe over here in this picture, that is the largest commissural of the brain, and that connects the cerebral cortex of the two cerebral hemisphere, and since it connects the neocortex, means your neopallium of the two sides, it attains enormous size, okay, and it is 10 cm long and nearly half of the anterior posterior length of the hemisphere, okay, and that consists of about 300 million fibers. Okay, so this corpus callosum that connects all the parts of the neocortex that you can observe over here of the two hemisphere, except for the lower end and the anterior part of the temporal lobe, which are connected by the anterior commissural fibers and the some other fibers that we will study later on. So this external feature of this corpus callosum actually and the relation that we have to see. So this corpus callosum that forms a massive arch interhemispheric bridge in the floor of the median longitudinal cerebral fissure that connecting the medial surface of the two cerebral hemispheres, and it forms massive and arch interhemispheric bridge flooring the midline longitudinal fissure and roofing both the lateral ventricles. Okay, and it lies nearer to the anterior end, that is 4 cm behind the frontal pole of the hemisphere, than the posterior end, that is 6 cm in front of the occipital lobe or the pole, that you can observe over here in this picture. In your sagittal section of the cerebrum, it is seen as the C-shaped mass of the white matter that you can find over here on the medial surface of the hemisphere, that is forming the roof of your lateral ventricle. Okay, so the concave inferior aspect of the corpus callosum, that is actually attached with the convex superior aspect of the fornix by the septum pellucidum, that you can observe over here, and its convex superior aspect, that is covered by a thin layer of gray matter, the indosium griseum, that is embedded, in which you will find the fiber bundles of bilateral medial and the lateral longitudinal stria. So the anterior cerebral vessels often lie on the pia mater, that covering its superior aspect of the corpus callosum, and the superior aspect of the corpus callosum, that is covered on each side by the cingulate gyrus, that separated by the collodial sulcus. So here we will see the parts of the corpus callosum. So the corpus callosum, that is divided from before backward into 4 parts, that is the rostrum. So this rostrum, that is actually marked in blue over here, genu, extends downward and backward as a thin prolongation to join the lamina terminalis, forming the rostrum of the corpus callosum. And this rostrum forms the floor of the anterior horn of your lateral ventricle. Okay, and its fibers extends inferiorly to connect the orbital surface of the two frontal lobes. Like that, here you will find the genu. So this genu, it is thick curved anterior extremity of corpus callosum, which lies 4 cm behind the frontal pole, and the genu, that forms the anterior boundary of the anterior horn of your lateral ventricle. So these fibers of genu that sweep forward, or you can say curve forward, on either side into the anterior parts of the frontal lobes, that will form a fork like structure. Okay, that is a forceps minor, that we will see in our next picture. Then you will find here the body, okay, or the trunk, that is the main, or you can say the middle part of the corpus callosum, between its thick anterior the genu and the posterior splenium extremities, and its fibers connect most of the frontal and the anterior part of the parietal lobes of the two cerebral hemisphere. And the central part of the corpus callosum, that forms the roof of the central part of the lateral ventricle. Like that, here you will find the splenium. Okay, so the splenium, that is the massive posterior extremity of the corpus callosum, that lying 6 cm in front of the occipital pole, and it overhangs the thalamic pulvinars, pineal gland and tectum of the midbrain. So this transverse fissure, that containing the telecoroidea of the third ventricle and posterior choroidal arteries and the great cerebral vein of Galen, that is located inferior to this splenium. So the fibers of the splenium that connects the posterior part of the parietal lobes and temporal and occipital lobes of the two hemispheres. The fibers connecting the occipital lobes sweep backward or curve backward on either side above the calcarine sulcus, forming a large fork-like structure that is your forceps major. Okay. So this forceps major forms a swelling in the upper part of the medial wall of the posterior horn of your lateral ventricle, that is the bulb of the posterior horn. Okay. So after this parts, if you trace laterally, so these fibers of the genu that curve forward into the frontal lobes and form the forceps minor. The fibers of the body that extends laterally is the radiation of the corpus callosum, and the fibers that form the splenium runs backward into the occipital lobe and form the forceps major. Okay. So here we'll see some function of this corpus callosum. So this corpus callosum, it is largely responsible for the interhemispheric transfer of information, which is essential for the bilateral response and in learning process. Its congenital absence of surgical division that doesn't produce any change in personality or intelligence, and patients remain completely unnoticed of any definite neurological disorder in day-to-day life. Only special test of the tactile and the visual system that will reveal any abnormalities. You'll find a syndrome over here that is known as the split brain syndrome. So if the corpus callosum is congenitally absent or sectioned surgically, each cerebral hemisphere that becomes isolated, and patient's response as if he has two separate brains, that is condition called as the split brain syndrome. The severance of the corpus callosum in young monkeys produces the split brain syndrome, that is so if they are trained to perform a task with one hand, they are unable to repeat the same act with the other hand. Okay. So lesions of this anterior corpus callosum result in akinetic mutism and the tactile anomia, whereas the lesions of the posterior corpus callosum results in alexia without agraphia. So you have to note over here that the section of this corpus callosum in past has been attempted surgically to prevent the spread of severe epileptic seizures from the hemisphere to the other. So after this, you will find the anterior commissure. So the anterior commissure, that is a small round bundle of the white matter fibers, which crosses the midline in the upper part of the lamina terminalis, immediately in front of the anterior column of the fornix and the interventricular foramen. Okay. So this anterior commissure, that is consist of mainly two components, a large posterior neocortical component which interconnects the lower and the anterior part of the temporal lobes. And you'll find a smaller anterior, or you can say the paleocortical component, which interconnects the olfactory regions, the olfactory bulb, olfactory tubercles, etc. of both the hemispheres. Okay. So, seen from below, the full extent of this anterior commissure that has the shape of a cupid's bow. So, like that, you'll find the posterior commissure. Okay. So this posterior commissure, that is a slender bundle of white matter fibers which crosses the midline through the inferior lamina of the stalk of the pineal gland. Okay, that you can observe over here in this picture, and it interconnects the superior colliculi, okay, pretectal and the interstitial nuclei of the two sides. Okay, and it lies in the inferior lamina of the stalk of this pineal gland, immediately above the opening of the cerebral aqueduct into the third ventricle. So, after this posterior commissure, you just come to this fornix. Okay, so this fornix, it is the prominent bundle that you can mark over here in red over here, that is seen on the medial aspect of the cerebral hemisphere, and it is made up of the fibers arising from the hippocampus. The body of the fornix, that is suspended from the corpus callosum by the septum pellucidum. Okay, the nerve fibers arise from the alveus, a thin layer of white matter that covering the surface of the hippocampus, and then converge to form the fimbria. Okay, so here you can see the fimbria. Okay, and here you will find the body of this fornix, and here you will find the septum pellucidum, and here at this point you will find this anterior commissure. Okay, and here you will find the amygdala. Okay, part of the amygdala, and here you will find the parahippocampal gyrus, and this is your hippocampus. Okay, so whole over this red in color, that is your fornix. Okay, so actually this fimbria that you will find over here, that is from the posterior column or the cross of the fornix, that arching below the corpus callosum. Okay, so here you will find this white in, that is the corpus callosum. Okay, so this fornix, that is actually the two crura, okay, that you will find over here in the midline to form the body of the fornix, and these two crura, they are interconnected by the fibers passing from the one to other, that is the hippocampal commissure of the fornix, which actually joins the two hippocampus. So, the anterior end of the body of the fornix, that is also divided into anterior columns of the pillar. Each anterior column of the fornix, that is, turns downward, that you can observe over here, just in front of the interventricular foramen, and passes through the hypothalamus to reach at the mammillary body, that you can observe over here about this mammillary body. So after this fornix, we will see about the habenular commissure. Okay, so what is this habenular commissure? So this habenular commissure that you will observe over here, you know, there is the presence of your epithalamus. Okay, so the epithalamus, that is actually the posterior wall of your third ventricle, there you will find the two nuclei. That nuclei is your habenular nuclei, and these habenular nuclei, both the side you will find, and that is actually connected by the bundle of white matter fibers, is a habenular commissure. Okay, so this habenular commissure, that is actually a slender bundle of the white matter fibers that crosses the midline through the superior stalk of your pineal gland, and it interconnects the habenular nuclei of both the sides. And these commissure that is associated with mainly the habenular nucleus. So after this habenular nucleus, we'll see about the association fibers. Okay. So these association fibers, is already I have told you that these association fibers are the fibers which connects, or the bundle of white matter fibers connects from anterior to posterior part of your cerebral hemisphere. Okay. The association fibers that interconnect the different regions of the cerebral cortex in the same hemisphere, that is, you can say the intrahemispheric fibers, and mainly these are of two types. Okay. You will find the short association fibers and the long association fibers. Okay. So what we'll do here? Here we'll just see the types of association fibers. So you can divide into two types, that is the short association fibers, or you can say that is the U fibers, or you can say the arcuate fibers, and also it is the long association fibers. Okay. So you can say the long association fibers that actually travels for long distance and that interconnects the widely separated gyri, okay, of the different lobes. So the short association fibers, that is the you can divide into other subtypes as a intercortical fibers, that is located in the deeper portion of the white matter, and the subcortical fibers, they are located just beneath the cortex. So like that, we will divide the long association fibers. So these types are as the uncinate fasciculus that connects the motor speech area and orbital cortex of the frontal lobe with the cortex of temporal pole by hooking around the stem of lateral sulcus, and it is narrow in middle and fanned out at both the ends. And here you can see the cingulum over here. So this cingulum is also the long association fibers, and that is also called as the limbic association bundle. And it is thick bundle of fibers that occupying the cingulate and the parahippocampal gyri, and it extends from the paraterminal gyrus to the oncus, that is forming the almost a circle like a girdle, that is the cingulum, or known as the girdle. So the name is given as the cingulum. Okay. So like that, you'll find the superior longitudinal fasciculus that you can find over here. So this superior longitudinal fasciculus, or the longitudinal bundle, it is the longest association bundle which connects the frontal lobe, okay, that you can observe over here, to the occipital and the temporal lobes. Like that, you'll find here the inferior in blue, you'll find the inferior longitudinal bundles. So these bundles, they interconnects the visual association area of the occipital lobe to the temporal lobe. Okay. So like that, you'll find the fronto-occipital bundle, and it commences in the frontal pole and runs backward to radiate into the occipital and temporal lobes. So this fronto-occipital bundles that pursues a similar course to that of the superior longitudinal fasciculus, but it lies deep to the superior longitudinal bundle, and it is separated from it by the fibers of your corona radiata. So all these fibers that you can see here about the short association fibers in green, okay, and the corpus callosum over here, they are the commissural fibers, and the superior longitudinal fasciculus is the association fibers, cingulum is the association fibers, and the uncinate fasciculus, that is also association fibers. And here you will find this inferior longitudinal fasciculus, that is also your association fibers. Okay, so after this we will find some projection fibers. Okay, so what is this projection fibers, right? So these projection fibers, they are actually as already I have told you, that these projection fibers connect the cerebral cortex to the subcortical centers, such as the corpus striatum, thalamus, the brainstem, or you can say the basal nuclei, and the spinal cord. So these fibers that you can observe over here in blue, they are actually connects the cerebral cortex with the lower part of the brain or the brainstem and the spinal cord in both direction, in superior direction and the inferior directions. Okay, so you'll find the superior direction and the inferior direction. So the superior direction, they are known as your corticopital, like your centripetal. So you can see the corticopital fibers, that is the afferent fibers that come to the cerebral cortex from other centers in the CNS. The corticofugal fibers, that is actually go away from the cortex, and you can say they are known as the efferent fiber to centers in the other part of the CNS. So the projection fibers of neocortex that constitute the corona radiata and the internal capsule, while all those of the allocortex, that is the archaeocortex and the paleocortex, that constitute the fimbria and the fornix. Okay, so the most important bundle of projection fibers are mainly the internal capsule and the fornix. So the corticofugal or the efferent fibers that proceeds from the cerebral cortex to the thalamus, brain stem or the spinal cord. So here we have completed the white matter fibers. So thanks for watching. Please like, share and subscribe to get the new videos. Okay, so thank you.